Good morning, all. So we get started here. Hopefully, my vocal cords aren't going to give out in the middle of this, but let's think positive. Okay, so how many Drupal beginners do we have in the room? Hands, please. Lovely. So this question. This very cheeky question up here may not be super meaningful to you yet, but Drupal has an enormous number of modules. These are the pieces of code that you can download that have been written by other members of the worldwide Drupal community, install on your site to give you all kinds of fun and useful functionality. But I mean, there are I should have checked the numbers, but I mean it's thousands upon thousands, and many of them are actually good. There's a lot that are garbage. But but there's a lot of stuff, and one of the intimidating things about getting started with Drupal can be figuring out which modules you actually need to use. So this is a talk about that. So the caveats here are, no, really, there are tons and tons of modules. What I'm going to tell you will hopefully be helpful. I mean, some of them, they're ones that just about literally every single person who's ever touched Drupal will use once they spin up with it. But as always, your mileage may vary. You may not like some of my choices, which is totally fine. My idea here is for some of the more experienced people in the room to feel free, more or less at any time, to jump in and let me know some that you like. And hopefully everybody will be able to take something away from this and feel more confident about your selections. In general, just one more caveat with this huge repository of code that we have to draw from, it can be very tempting to just download everything, just grab all the stuff and then turn it all on and see what happens, and your site will just come screeching to a halt. Drupal is a large framework. It has a pretty big code footprint. It has a pretty big memory footprint compared to some other, software that does similar things. So for the sake of both your web server and your own personal sanity as a site builder, developer, team member, whatever you are, avoid the module salad bar. It can be a little bit difficult. Try and just pick the ones that you really need and just get rid of everything else. So I have a lot of modules in here that we could talk about. So if I start to turn into the Micro Machines man or something, just feel free to raise your hand and tell me to slow down a little bit. I don't think it's going to be a big problem, but you never know. I mean, there's 80 modules in here or something. So yes? Oh yeah. I'm talking about just the contributed modules that you might choose to download. After you've selected the ones that you like, you can get rid of the ones that you were messing with. Yeah.
Can you point out which of these are 6, which are 7, which are both?
Yeah, most of the modules in here. I mean, I'm still doing the bulk of my client work on Drupal 6. I am starting to get into Drupal 7. I do have specific highlights of things that are only for Drupal 7 and a couple that are only for Drupal 6 usually it's just because somebody hasn't ported it yet or whatever. But the lion's share of these modules are actually already, they are available for both. In most cases, hopefully I'll be able to pull that off the top of my head, but you can always check later. And besides, it's always, with any of these modules that is not available for Drupal 7 yet, it's a good opportunity for those of you who are more of the developer type persuasion to help bring them forward. If some of the useful ones, the useful and popular ones that people want, but just maybe haven't gotten ported yet, to bring them to Drupal 7. But anyway, jumping in here. So Views module. Anybody here hasn't heard of Views? I'm just curious. Okay, there are a couple people. Views is the pretty much the just about the first thing you're probably going to find yourself wanting as you're building out stuff. It very, very short. It's for building lists of stuff. That is a gross oversimplification. Those of you who do know what Views is, you've probably already heard this, maybe even from me, but the developer of, or the head maintainer of Views, the primary developer, Earl Miles, is going to be here tomorrow. If you use Views on a regular basis, and if you're like me, you think this guy is the bee's knees, maybe you'd like to shake his hand and thank him for his work. He's going to be here tomorrow. Panels is an Earl Miles joint, if you will. That is a module for cutting up pages and putting content of various kinds into those regions. You can do it with everything on your site. You can take over your Node edit forms. You can do your user-facing content. You can do the auto-generated taxonomy listings. You can do all kinds of stuff with panels. Definitely something worth looking into. IMCE, I don't remember what it stands for, but it is a file manager for, usually the I stands for image, I know that. It's kind of targeted toward the management of images, but you can manage other files with it as well. It's a very popular one. It has a pretty nice user interface. It does have one small hole in the main distribution of it, which is that it does not let you create subdirectories. So for that, you need a module called IMCE mkdir, ask for it by name. WYSIWYG. Drupal does not come bundled with a what you see is what you get content editor like TinyMCE, CK editor, BU editor, you know, any of those things. Not built in to, and many of those many of those frameworks have their own modules. So for CK Editor and TinyMCE, you can actually download CK Editor module. But WYSIWYG module provides you with the ability to hook up. You can install many of the WYSIWYG editors, and on a per content type basis, you can enable multiple, and then you can switch between them depending on various conditions. Pretty nifty. And if you want to use it with IMCE to hook up your little image button in your little toolbar to a file browser, there's a little separate module called WYSIWYG IMCE Bridge that you will need to just connect them. It pretty much does nothing except connect them up. Web form module. This is for creating user-facing web forms, usually the idea being that it's something that is like a poll, or you could use it for contact forms, anything where all you need to do is just collect some data from the user, and that's all you need to do. It's not for, it kind of works alongside the built-in Node system where you can, you know, create fields and do all that stuff there. Rules. Rules module will let you set up, as it says, rules that can be triggered by different conditions and will do things. So you can say, it provides you, any of these things, obviously, you can do in code. That just goes without saying. But the idea is that a lot of these things provide a user interface. So rules provides you a user interface whereby you can say, all right, when somebody creates a node of a specific type, dispatch an email to a particular email address. And you can, it gives you a nice way to do that. Yes? The trigger module is built in. Rules is just, it's a contributed version that does kind of a lot of the same things and more. Yes?
What's the syntax of
rules? The syntax of rules, it's graphical. You can write, I'm pretty sure I'm not over-promising here, but the idea is that rules provide you ways to do these things using a user interface instead of having to write PHP.
But it's
executing PHP, yes. Beg your pardon? Yes. Yeah. Sorry. I didn't restate that question. Yes. It is similar to triggers, but it's like a yes and kind of situation. Yes, it's like triggers and it does more.
So
yes.
Would you recommend using rules rather than triggers?
Rules is easier to use in a lot of ways, and it lets you create more things than, like, actions and triggers to me, it's something that's built into Drupal core, both in 6 and 7. It's just the kind of thing that a lot of people don't use because it kind of looks like it doesn't do enough useful things, and rules provide you with that ability. It is a large module, though, so, you know, if the squeezing every drop of performance out of your site is important to you, you might, you know, try and get by with actions and triggers. Yes?
You're right, Joe, that it's a big module, and since it's kind of an API module, it does a lot of things, but there's a really good series of how to use it from Node 1.
Yeah, that's node 1. That's node, the letter, the word 1 spelled out, .se. So you can. They have a learning series on rules and lots of other modules. I'm going to move on here. Flag module lets. I mean, this is not, you know, flag as a stake in the ground, but like flag as in flag this as inappropriate, or, you know, allows users to. You can determine situations whereby nodes or entities in Drupal 7 can have flags that your users can interact with. So you could use flag to create something like a favorite nodes system per user, or you can say, you know, you can have global flags that once someone clicks it, it's like it's a switch that's flipped on. So you. For something like flag is inappropriate, or, you know, send this comment to a moderator or whatever. And you can also have things that are just flags managed per user. Yes?
Are the flags just binary, yes, no?
Yes. Okay. Yep. Backup and migrate is a module that lets you create backups of your database, and just provides you a nice user interface for doing that. You can, I believe, hook into cron to have it do some of those things automatically for you. If you are not comfortable with something like Drush or doing things through a more conventional database manager outside of Drupal, you could look at backup and migrate module to help you dump your database and back it up. And the migrate portion is you can also upload things to another Drupal site to give you a nice in the browser method of moving your data from one site to another. Yes? I'm pretty sure the answer to that is no. It's somebody can correct me if they know this, but I'm pretty sure that it concerns itself only with the database. Yeah?
You're correct, Joe, but there is a module for that. There is a file migrate module. I haven't used it, but I don't know what it is.
Okay, so there's a file migrate module as well that you can look into. Path auto. This lets you create. So when you normally create a piece of content, say you create a node on your Drupal site, you get a URL that is, unlike some other, you know, content management systems I could name that have crazy URLs, it gives you something very simple. You know, node/a number. That's fine. Short, whatever. But maybe you would like something a little more verbose that lists out the sections of the site or whatever. Basically, any kind of, if you want to create a nice URL automatically when content is created, Path Auto is what you want. Beg your pardon?
How does that interact with Drupal 7?
It interacts very well with Drupal 7.
Okay, I thought Drupal 7
would
let you do that on the box.
I'm not sure exactly what the Path Auto does still exist and contribute for Drupal 7. And so I think it just might give you some more settings or something. But it does coexist. Global redirect is kind of related to that. It's a very small module that pretty much just allows the notion of a canonical URL for any given piece of content. So if you in Drupal, you can create a whole bunch of different aliases that all refer to the same object. So like, for example, if you're using Path Auto, you'll have your built-in system path, which is node/number, but then you could also have your path auto thing, which could be really long and verbose and, you know, understandable. And global redirect will make sure that anyone who hits one of them basically it'll take the node 30 or whatever and redirect you over to the other one. It's nice for just keeping things straight. String overrides is a module that will let you change every occurrence of a particular string on your site to something else. So like if you want an easy way to say, oh, I don't want this to be called forums on my site. I want it to be called message board. You can install string overrides and just type that in and it will take care of it for you. UberCart and Drupal Commerce. UberCart is available, is the king of commerce in Drupal 6. Drupal Commerce is a much newer. It is exclusively for Drupal 7, but these are the two main packages that you might be looking at if you want to sell things using Drupal. Yes?
Are they both in compliance with the banking changes this last couple of months? Are they both in compliance with the banking requirements for handling customers' confidential information?
Oh, PCI? Is that what you mean? That is a more complicated question. I'm going to say you can be in PCI compliance using these things. I mean, there's a lot more to it than that, but yes. Feeds module. If you're ever dealing with something like you want to pull in content from Twitter or anything that features an RSS feed and you want to bring that content into your site, feeds module is what you're looking for. Another very useful use case for feeds is if you want to, say, migrate in. There will be other modules I'll talk about that can do this, but if you're migrating from, say, WordPress to Drupal or something, you can use a feed of data from another site to import a bunch of content and map it to your fields in Drupal. It's kind of ridiculously handy. Yes?
Is feed module compatible with Facebook feeds?
Facebook does not provide RSS feeds or feeds of any kind, really. Does it not? Am I right about that? Okay, so if you can find some kind of Atom or RSS feed, it would be compatible. But if you want to be dealing with Facebook stuff, there are other modules that will probably do a better job that actually use the Facebook API. Feeds module does not. But yeah, feeds is good for bringing in data, or for just bringing in kind of arbitrary data, or for creating nodes based on feeds. It's really slick, very powerful. Boost module is if you develop sites for smaller clients that use shared hosting, you almost absolutely must have Boost module, or you should be familiar with it and have it available, because it allows you to basically staticize your Drupal site for anonymous users. So what it'll do is it'll create static versions of the rendered versions of the pages of your site, and will serve those instead of bootstrapping and like dealing with any Drupal stuff at all. So in any kind of situation where performance for users that are not logged into your site is important, Boost module is the way to go. Ask for it by name. Whoops. These modules are, if you're still developing Drupal 6, you absolutely pretty much must have, you're probably going to want these at some point. These are all in core in Drupal 7. So CCK is the content construction kit. That is the way by which you can have fields on your stuff. Drupal 7 has that built in, and it can put fields on anything. CCK will let you put fields on nodes in Drupal 6. Token module will take pieces of data. It's like metadata for your nodes, and it will provide those things to other modules. It's basically a module that just helps, for the most part, helps other modules give you stuff. So like in Path Auto, for example, you can say, all right, I want my URL to be the taxonomy path to the node with the node ID on the end. And instead of having to write a bunch of PHP code to figure out how the heck to get all that stuff, if you have, Path Auto requires token, so token module will give you square bracketed strings that say, all right, give me my taxonomy path, blip, / node ID. And then you save that, and it will do it for you. Really great. File field and image field. File management is now built into Drupal 7. You're still going to probably butt heads with it, but it's built in. But in Drupal 6, you need these things to allow easy file uploads on a per-content basis. Drupal 6 does come with the upload module, but I would suggest never turning it on and just use file field and image field to give you to give you the facility to deal with uploads. I mean, dealing with media and uploads is a very active and large sort of headbutting topic in Drupal, no matter the version. But this is the best practice in terms of Drupal 6. Image cache has been renamed image styles in Drupal 7 because it makes a little more sense. What it does is it allows you to create derivative images of uploads. So what I mean by that is you can upload, say, like some, you have a site where you want people to be able to upload photos, but people don't always know how to resize a photo before they upload it to the site. And if you just dump out whatever they've uploaded, you could blow your page out with an enormous image. So with image cache, you can set presets that say, all right, when I serve this node, instead of using the full-size giant version of this image, I would like you to give me one that's only 600 pixels wide, keeping the aspect ratio. Or, you know, maybe I'd like to do other stuff to it. And it will create those things for you and allow you not only to create them, but then if you decide to change your mind later, like, oh, I didn't mean 600, I meant 500, you can just change the setting, hit a flush button to ditch all the images you've generated, not change anything else, and just let Drupal do everything for you. So the next time somebody hits that page where a request for that image is made, Drupal will regenerate a 500 pixel version of it for you and save it for later. It caches it so that it only has to do the generation once. Really great. Look it up. And poor man's cron, the cron file, cron.php in Drupal, is something that you would set up. In the old days, you would have to do this manually. But the idea is that every, you know, so often, however often it is for your site, Drupal needs to do some stuff. Like it maybe it needs to clear out its log, or it needs to send out queued up emails or whatever. There's like periodic tasks that Drupal needs to do every once in a while. And in the old days, you would have to get all this crap set up manually. Poor man's cron will just, every time any page loads, it will look and say, has cron been run recently? It hasn't? Okay, do it. And then it will just do nothing for a while. Yes?
If I use this in D6 and I'm moving to D7, mm-hmm. does it mean that I don't have to reinstall these modules?
That is correct. Yep, when you migrate from Drupal 6 to Drupal 7, these modules, if you use the upgrade status module, you will be able to, if you have a Drupal 6 installation that you're interested in moving to Drupal 7, you can install upgrade status, as opposed to the built-in update status. An upgrade status will give you a table listing out all the modules you have installed, and it will tell you what the status is of that module in Drupal 7. And it will say, for something like poor man's cron, it will say, this is in core now, you can uninstall it. So that is helpful. Okay, dealing with files and images. We're getting into the stuff that's a little bit away from, like, if you're a very beginner to Drupal, these may feel like hammers looking for nails, but you may run into this stuff. So here we go. File field sources lets you, when you have a file field on a node, or yeah, I guess in Drupal 6 it's always going to be a node, but when you have a file field, normally what happens is you get, you know, your browser's native browse for a file thing and upload. That's it. So like if you want to share an image between different nodes, you have to upload a new copy every time. File field sources gives you the option of using, for example, IMCE. So you could say, all right, I don't want to upload something new. I just want to use a file I've already uploaded. So let me pick it using IMCE. And it lets you do that. It can also do things like pull in remote images. So you could say, I want to pull in somebody's Twitter avatar. Let me go grab the link to it. And then file field sources will pull the image in, save a copy of it for you. Really quite useful. File field paths lets you tie into token module, and it provides when you're creating a file field, you can tell Drupal where you want that file to be stored, but certain things by default are not provided to you. So like if you wanted to say, all right, what I want to do for this node is I want all my images for this thing to be stored in a path that includes the title of this node or the node ID, whatever. You want that level of granularity in your file storage. It is not provided by default. You need file field paths to do that. JavaScript image crop. If you want to be able to provide your users with the ability to crop to custom crop an image. This is especially useful if you're using something like image cache. It requires image cache, actually. If you want to be able to say, like, do the thing where, like, on Facebook, for example, it'll let you say, oh, you know, that thumbnail that you created for my profile picture, that's not what I really want. My face is actually over here. Let me move this little rectangle, you know, in my browser to show you. No, this is the part I want. JavaScript image crop will let you do that. So you can use it in combination with image cache to set up custom cropping and just give that control over to your content administrators. Image resize filter. This is another option for controlling the size of giant uploaded images. So if you are using a WYSIWYG editor, which it requires, at least I think. It doesn't require that. All it requires is that it will look through. It's an input filter, so that that's something that you would need to turn on through the text format or input format system in Drupal 7 or Drupal 6, and it will look at every image tag, and it will extract out the width and the height that's defined in that image tag. And it will save a version of the image that is exactly that size. So that is great. If you want to be able to allow people to just upload an image and resize it right in a WYSIWYG editor, and then not have, because you know what usually happens if you just scale an image down visually, is it still has to load that giant thing, which makes the page slower, and depending on the browser, it can look like garbage. So image resize filter lets you mitigate that problem. Swift upload and PL upload are two ways that you can allow people to upload multiple files at the same time into a file field. So like every file field can, if you tell it to, store multiple copies of something. But if I want to upload a bunch of images, I have to manually go, okay, select that image, select that image, select that image. And then, you know, you can upload them all at once, but the selection has to happen in separate steps. These modules, one of which requires Flash, that's Swift Upload. The other one has a framework. It's a framework that's more general. It can use Silverlight. It can use, you know, a bunch of other stuff that provides you with mechanisms where you can just hit the browse button once, select a ton of images or whatever the files are, and upload them all at once. Image Cache Actions is an image cache module, that provides you the ability to do different things that are not built into image cache normally, like some of the ones I've used are just being able to adjust the brightness or contrast of your derivative image. So like a use case for this for me was I wanted users to be able to upload their avatar, their picture, but then when the users are presented on a user page, I wanted to be able to auto-generate the on and off mouseover states of each image. So, you know, I wanted the off one to be grayscale and a little brighter so that when you roll over the image, it's still a thumbnail, but, you know, it all highlights and stuff. So you can use image cache actions to generate all these different presets that you can then use to generate other different stuff. In Drupal 7, the big push for trying to bring some sanity to the management of media is Media Module. I personally have not used it yet, but I've been following its development. And so if you're interested in this sort of stuff, if you are building a site on Drupal 7, you should definitely look at Media Module, and it will hopefully be helpful. Yes?
Does Media replace everything on the left?
No, it does not. Okay. That's just a visual artifact. I don't know what you could say it replaces, but it's intended to be a better solution generally for the management of your files in Drupal 7. Okay, so if you are using CCK or fields or what have you, in regardless of the Drupal version, you may want different types of stuff. Drupal 7 especially includes a lot of different field types by default. You have text fields, you can have, you know, text areas, you can have text fields that let you choose their input format, all that sort of thing. But maybe you'd want something more structured. So Date module pretty much just provides you with the ability to create actual dates with timestamps. Drupal 7 has that built in, Drupal 6 does not. But their date module for Drupal 7 gives you additional power and different things for hooking into views and all sorts of stuff with your dates. Link module, yes. You can still.
Do you want to use this instead of what's in
G7? It's not an instead. It's like a more thing. It's kind of so it will just kind of bolster the ability, bolster you know core dates abilities. You can install it and it will work fine in Drupal 7. Link module lets you create links. So I mean you can use text fields for this obviously, but link will provide you with you can. It will do, you know, it can do validation of a link for you. It can do things like recognizing, it can auto-activate a URL. It can say, you know, I want to open this in a new window, or maybe I don't. It can set the actual URL and then a separate text, you know, a separate title, the text that's actually displayed instead of the raw link. It can do all that stuff for you. Similarly, email module will gives you just an email field. Which again, you know, it just provides the validation, which is nice. M field is the it's actually embedded media field. So if you want to include YouTube videos or you know different stuff like that, you can obviously just stick the embed code right from YouTube in your body field or whatever. But embedded media field will let you do things like, I have a URL for a YouTube video. I'm too lazy to go figure out what the current version of the embed code is for YouTube. So I'm just going to put the URL in and you handle everything else for me. And it also, you know, it allows you to stay separate from your body field and not pollute it with a bunch of extra data. Yes. I cannot speak to that. I mean, media assumes that it's the stuff that you're actually keeping on your own Drupal site. I could be wrong about that, though. I'm not sure what the interaction is between that and media. So that's a question for further investigation. Select or other lets you do, instead of having two fields where you say, all right, choose from all these options. Oh, and if you have an other, here's a totally separately stored text field that does with your other option. It just gives you all that stuff in one package. So you can provide a list of options and then have your other text field built in. Pre-populate module will let you take from the query string of, so let's say you wanted to pre-populate a bunch of fields on a node edit form. You can do that in different ways with a bunch of code, but if you use pre-populate module, you can say, all right, when somebody hits node/add/page, ?, body equals blah. This module will automatically, it will pull that out of the URL and fill in your body field with blah. so if you have different situations where you want to be able to pre-populate modules based on special links or based on bookmarklets, if you want to create those, it lets you do that. In Drupal 7, the functionality that in so a lot of the functions of CCK were brought into Drupal core for version 7. Most of the stuff related to fields. User and node references, which are just pointers to other content, and groups of fields were not included, and those still remain in contrib, and they have their own modules that that are called references and field groups. So if you want that functionality, you need to install those separately. Okay, so this is related more some theming, but just generally dealing with navigation here. Menu block is one of my favorite modules. I love this thing. Anytime you want to create a block with navigation, I'm just going to say it, you should be using menu block. You can use some of the built-in things like turning on primary navigation or secondary navigation in your theme. I pretty much never do that. I use menu block instead, because menu block is hugely powerful and provides you with a lot of stuff that's very nice for theming. So anytime it sticks a menu on a page, it gives you classes and IDs for every single item in the menu automatically that don't conflict with anything. It can also look at the context of the page that is currently loaded, and if you want it to, it can change the display of a menu based on that context. It does a whole bunch of stuff. Definitely give it a look. Menu attributes will let you add classes, IDs, target attributes. It basically just in the Drupal menu editing system, all you can do by default really is give it a path and a name. And so menu attributes just expands what every single menu item in Drupal is capable of storing and displaying in your theme. Menu block provides classes and IDs and stuff, but if you need something more, menu attributes can get you there. Path redirect is a way to let you... You can create URL aliases to things in Drupal. So you can say, I want, you know, mysite.com/frontpage to point to some node. But if you want to have mysite.com/Facebook point to my Facebook page for this company or whatever, you can't do that using the built-in features. And if you don't want to write the stuff that you would stick in your Drupal htaccess file, you can use path redirect to do it in the user interface. And you don't have to use it for external links, but that's a very common use case. But any situation where you want a path to redirect, use path redirect. Custom breadcrumbs and menu breadcrumb are both trying to deal with the occasional nightmare that is breadcrumb management in Drupal. It's just a little bit horrifying at times and desperately in need of more attention, I think, even in Drupal 7. But custom breadcrumbs lets you do things where you're saying, you can basically have any arbitrary breadcrumb you want for content types or users or whatever. So if, for example, I'll step back for a second. Menu breadcrumb will let you assign content types to menus, and then it will create, you know, a hierarchical breadcrumb based on where in the menu system that piece of content lives. Custom breadcrumbs is a little bigger than that and will let you do things that are more arbitrary. So give them a look. Pathologic is an input filter. So you would put this on a field or in an input format that's assigned to a field. And it tries to help you avoid broken links on your website. So it will do things like make educated guesses about what links in this field, in this HTML, are internal links and make sure that they still work. It also provides you the ability to create actual explicit internal links. You could say, you know, if you're writing HTML, a href equals internal colon node /30, and it will write out a link to node 30. But it won't just use node 30. It will actually, you know, tie into the Drupal functions that say, okay, what's the real path for node 30? And it will give you that instead. But if you decide to change that path, that pathologic will always check and make sure that that link stays updated, even if your alias for that node changes.
Are you referring to the absolute path?
It does help you with the management of absolute paths. So... basically, another thing it will do is if you move your website and your links, like you move it from, say, dev to www.whatever.com, you can set in Pathologic settings, hey, I just moved this site. This it used to be dev. This is now live. So will you just please update those links for me? And it'll go, yes, I'd love to do that for you. It won't talk to you. Don't worry. It's not going to talk to you much. These are for people who are more interested in the development side. Devel module. Devel module is actually good for themers as well. It's good for everybody when you're in development. It gives you a breakdown of from a theming perspective. It gives you a breakdown of all the PHP code and just the data that make up an object of interest. So once you install Devel, as long as you have access, as long as you have permissions, if you're an administrator, you certainly will, you will be able to see a link on the page called Devel. It's a tab next to View and Edit. And so you hit that thing, and then it will give you different stages of the building and rendering of that thing, and then you can inspect it. So it just gives you a nice way of inspecting that stuff. It also, if you're a developer or if you're somebody that's concerned with performance, it does provide some things like query inspection, so you can find out all the MySQL queries that have gone into the building of this page that I'm looking at right now. It gives you memory footprint stuff. So it gives you a lot of very useful tools. Let's see, it also provides the ability to switch users. So you can masquerade. There's also a masquerade module that will do this, but Develop provides it. You can switch to another user and browse the site as another user without having to, you can't know their password unless you just happen to know it, but you can't get it out of the database. So Develop will allow you to just, you know, fake it. And again, you want to be careful about this. Don't leave it installed on a live site. But when you're in development, it's very handy. Drush is not exactly a module. It's a command line tool that Chris Charlton is going to be giving a talk on later. If you are reasonably comfortable with the command line on your operating system of choice, you should definitely be using Drush in your Drupal site building. It gives you commands that will install modules. It gives you commands to run database updates, clear your cache. A bunch of contributed modules provide things that just basically let you do things that you would, if otherwise you would have to be clicking through a bunch of screens in Drupal to try and do. Drush lets you do them in one step on the command line. It is totally fabulous. And it's worth getting into the command line just to have it available. And you can talk to lots of us nerds about that. Features will package up configuration on your Drupal site and dump it into modules for you. So if you want to say, if you're working on a development version of something and you create a content type and you've just, you know, gone through and you've put all the fields just where you want them and you've messed around with display suite to get everything looking just the way you want it to, and then you have to move the thing to another site, you don't want to have to do that again from scratch. So features will package all that stuff up for you into a module. You don't write a line of code. And you hit the create feature, it downloads the module for you, or if you're developing on your own machine, it downloads it. But it creates a module for you that you can then install on your site. You can install it on your development version. You can install it on the live version, whatever. It allows the portability of configuration stuff and and allowing you to move it around. Incidentally, that again, just like views, that is like a tip of the iceberg kind of deal here. It is one of the ways that professional Drupal folks try to solve the problem of deploying stuff. And yes?
How does it differ from back in the database and install?
Well, the main thing is that everything becomes a module, so it's in code, which if you're using version control means that you can manage updates. And features also will help you figure out if something has changed. So like if I started out with a content type defined by a feature in a certain way and then I change it, features module will look at that and say, hey, you changed something, would you like to update this? Really it's something that you just need to look into and it will, the difference will become clear, or I can talk to you about it. Boxes module is, so features, boxes, context, and strong arm are all sort of members of a suite of modules that was that is now being maintained by a company called Phase 2. Originally were built by another huge Drupal shop called Development Seed. And they're all about trying to make deployment of stuff easier. Boxes module, it's basically the same thing as the built-in custom block creation, except it includes the ability to dump your blocks into a feature. So if that means nothing to you, don't worry about it. But you might consider, if you're allowing the creation of custom blocks on any site at all, you might consider installing Boxes module and using it instead of the one that's built in. Oh, there's applause in the other room. I'm wondering how short a time I am. Whoa! All right. So, I need to hire the micro machines, man. This is ridiculous, folks. I'm going to skip a bunch of these. So Display Suite, look for the talk that I gave and totally lost my voice in on that. Sections module lets you set up lets you change the theme on your site based on the path. IE CSS Optimizer, if you're a themer and you've ever run into the problem where Internet Explorer cannot load more than 31 style sheets, this is the module you need. I run into it all the time. If you have a lot of Drupal modules, a lot of them provide CSS, it's really handy. Let's see, what else is good? Zen, Omega, and Fusion are all themes that are really good for starting out. If you're building a custom theme, they're frameworks that will that are good starting points that provide you with some nice stuff. I'm going to skip the other ones here. Let's see. Okay, Node Queue. You want to reorder a bunch. You want to have an arbitrary list of nodes and allow a user interface where they can drag around and choose a custom order for things. Node Queue is the answer. Node Clone, just what it says. Lets you clone nodes. Will pre-populate all the fields with with an existing node's stuff, and you can change them. Taxonomy Manager, self-explanatory. Active Tags, if you have a tags taxonomy, it provides a nice user interface for existing tags, so you don't necessarily have to just use autocomplete. Vertical Tabs is for Drupal 6, gives you the Vertical Tabs functionality from Drupal 7. Let's see, what else is juicy on here? TAC Lite is Taxonomy Access Control Lite, and it gives you the ability to set up access on your site depending, like you can make certain aspects of your site private, for example, by setting up a taxonomy term that you assign to certain content, and then when somebody hits a piece of content that's tagged that way, they will or will not have access to it depending on how you configure it. Drupal 7, look at Workbench if you are interested in editorial workflows. It's like the new hot thing. Drupal 6, there is no Drupal 7 of Moderate module, but I've used it a lot in Drupal 6 to just allow easy moderation of stuff. So if you want users to be able to submit stuff but not have it get published right away, if you need an editorial process, it's a really simple one with a nice UI. Let's see. Oh, good. Okay, I was actually closer than I thought. So we'll go through these real quick. Domain Access is a suite of modules that will set up your site. When you have a Drupal site, built into the box is the ability to host multiple sites from a single core installation. Domain Access is sort of similar, but a bajillion times more powerful. It will let you do things as simple as switching a theme based on a domain for your Drupal site. It will also do things like, let's say you have a giant worldwide website and you have different countries or different states, and each of them wants to share the same general pool of content, but it needs to get farmed out in different ways to the different states. Domain Access provides that. Drupad, those of you who have iOS devices, iPhones, iPads, and stuff, it's a module and app combination. The app is like $5 or $10 that gives you a nice native app way of managing stuff on your Drupal site. Search by page, will index the pages as rendered of your Drupal site and hook that into the core search function, which is different from just doing queries and searching node content. Services and Views Data Source will give you the ability to ship out data from your Drupal site in different useful formats for basically for external services. So if you want to build, say, a mobile app and you want to, you know, provide data from a view in JSON format or something, you can use services to do that. Views Data Source, I can't remember, it's like a smaller and easier subset of services. And so those two things are good for that. Reverse Node Reference, if you use Node References, you might want it. That's all I'm going to say. Better Formats gives you better control over input formats. It's pretty much, I think it's only for Drupal 6 at the moment because most of the functionality in it is somehow built into Drupal 7. But it lets you do things like say, all right, all my pages should use the full HTML input format. All my articles should use filtered HTML or, you know, what have you. And you can set up hierarchies of which input formats should be used for different kinds of users. Yes?
Can you tell me how great this is? Kind of a duh question.
Uh-huh.
Is this online somewhere?
This will be online. Yep, every presentation that you see today is recorded and the slides will be available as well.
All right.
Web form validation lets you set up validation on your web forms. Basically, it gives you a user interface for setting up regular expressions to validate data on submission for your web forms. Swift tools, if you're using Flash audio players or video players or that sort of thing on your site, look at Swift tools. Open Graph meta tags, this is for Facebook stuff or other social web things. If you want to be able to set up like all the huge like a bunch of meta tags for socializing your website, take a look at that. And finally, if you're migrating from a WordPress site into Drupal and you're using Drupal 6, dig WordPress import. I've used it several times. It lets you take WordPress's native data dump format, the WXL format or whatever it is, and it is just great. It lets you map all the fields into different content types and stuff. You do multiple imports over and over again, so if content changes, it will help you out with that. It's really, really great, and I've used it several times, and I love it. In Drupal 7, there is a WordPress migrate module, which does similar stuff. The user interface is a little more complicated, I think, but that's where you want to look for that. if you want to find more stuff, come to LA Drupal meetups. Talk to people here. We are all very friendly, are we not? We're all just here to talk and share knowledge. You can, of course, look at the Drupal the modules overview page. That's everything. DrupalModules.com is a totally separate third-party website that indexes all of Drupal Contrib and gives you some ways of searching modules that are a little nicer than the ones that are provided on Drupal.org. Drupal Watchdog is a relatively new website. It's kind of like a Drupal magazine, but there are features on modules from time to time. And another place that I look is the Lullabot blog, and they have a series called Module Monday that they've been doing for a couple of months where they just highlight some module of interest that is, generally speaking, not very well known and give you the skinny on it. Several modules that were in this talk came from them. So, thank you for listening, and have a good rest of your day. Is it time for lunch?